from the drawer to her own purse. They were suddenly interrupted by old MacDonald himself. We called up all the winning dignity of our sex to do what must be done. Sophia shrieked and fainted, and I screamed and instantly ran mad. Finally, we regained our senses, escaped and hastened to London. We began to think of returning to our mothers, but accidentally heard that they had both starved to death.
Fanny!
Goodbye, Susie. Goodbye. Think of lots of good stories for me and eat thousands of tarts.
You little girl, continue to brush your hair, but not all off.
Fanny, he's here. Wake up. Say goodbye to your sister. Sorry for the delay.
Don't worry along, then.
Goodbye.
Come on, ain't that easy.
My regards to my sisters.
Yes, Mama. And you will write to tell me when I'm to return. Mama?
Oh, get on
now. Bye! Bye, Susie. Goodbye!
Black cargo, miss.
Black cargo?
Right. Slaves. Probably some captain or heroic ship doctor brought home a few darkies as gifts for the wife.
Well, get on there.
Hello?
Yeah, it's 5 o'clock in the morning.
And Mrs. Norris arranged for this girl we brought here. It's her niece or something.
Mrs. Norris lives in the parsonage over there.
I was told most definitely to drop her at the front entrance of Mansfield Park.
Then drop her.
Aunt Norris.
Yes, yes. He brought you 2 hours too early. Come in.
Ellis, gather up the children. Now let us have a look at you. Well, I'm sure you have other qualities. Sir Thomas, she's here. Our new little charge.
Hello, Fanny.
Hello, Sir Thomas. Greetings from my family, sir.
Yes, thank you. How was your journey?
Lovely, sir. I had no idea England was so big.
Yeah, but you came, what, 100 miles?
Yes, sir. Impressive.
Indeed it is. Well, then, why don't you get us settled in with you and Mr. Norris at the parsonage, and we'll introduce the children later.
With Mr. Norris and myself?
Yes, I thought...
No. There's been a misunderstanding, sir. When I suggested that we take in my sister, Lady Bertram's, and my poor niece, I wouldn't...
Please do not trouble yourself on my behalf.
Shh. You speak when you're spoken to.
Will you excuse us, Miss Price?
Good morning. I am Maria Elizabeth Bertram.
And I am Julia Frances Bertram. Pleased to make your acquaintance.
Pleased to meet you.
It might not be wise to have her here in the house with the boys.
If you breed her up with them from this time, and suppose her even to have the beauty of an angel, she'll never be more to either than a sister.
Well, I suppose there's truth to that. Well, then it's settled. Maria, Julia, listen. We must prepare ourselves for gross ignorance, some meanness of opinion, and a certain vulgarity of manner.
These are not incurable faults.
I hope she will not tease my poor pug. I have but just persuaded Julia to leave him alone.
Of course not, my dear. But you girls must never be arrogant towards her. She is not your equal. But that must never be apparent to her. It is a point of great delicacy.
Of great delicacy, yes. Dining parlour through there, over there the conservatory, and that way down to the cellars. I hope you don't tend towards sulkiness, dear. Your mother certainly had the inclination.
Clearly marrying to disoblige her family.
That's the West Wing. Soon to be repaired if Tom could set aside his horses and the dice for long enough. The billiard room, for the men, of course. Remember, there is moderation in all things. Yes, yes, Tom did it of himself. Very modern, very modern. Sir Thomas' extraordinary library. Come along, haven't got all day. And here is Sir Thomas' study. Never disturb him here. He is weighed down with some very great cares at the moment. This is his personal sanctuary. The maids' rooms, manservants' rooms down there. You will be my assistant, you understand. And up here, what was formerly the nursery and then the governor's room, is now your very own room.
Excuse me?
Yes?
How long am I expected to remain here?
Well, that depends, doesn't it? But if all goes well, forever.
Dear Susie, it seems that Mother has given me away, and I can augur nothing but misery from all I have seen at Mansfield Park.
Don't worry, I'm all for crying. Makes your hair grow.
Don't make fun of me.
Thank you. Is it working?
Is what working?
My behaviour. Is it making you feel better?
It's certainly distracting.
Good. Anyway, I'm Edmund. So, who do you miss?
I told Edmund about you especially, Susie. He asked me if I wished to write to you, and I said I had no paper. And didn't he give me enough for more letters and stories than you shall ever want to receive. By the way, Eliza eloped to Paris with her lover. Unfortunately, she lived beyond her means and was imprisoned and partially eaten by her two young sons. But she intends to murder the guards. I'll keep you abreast of any further developments. P.S. Could you please assure Mother that I'm improving myself daily? The history of England. Henry VI. It was in this reign that Joan of Arc lived and made such a fuss among the English. They should not have burnt her, but they did.
Henry VIII. I'll save you the task of hearing what you've already heard, and myself of recounting what I do not perfectly recollect. Justice and duty, however...
And then that disgrace to humanity, that pest of society, Elizabeth, who, murderous and wicked queen that she was, confined her cousin, the lovely Mary Queen of Scots, for 19 years, and then brought her to an untimely, unmerited, and scandalous death. Much to the eternal shame of the monarchy and the entire kingdom.
By a partial, prejudiced, and ignorant historian. Banner, you are awful.
All those quarrels and wars. The men all good for nothing, and hardly any women at all.
It's very tiresome. I often think it odd that history should be so dull. Mm. A great deal of it must be invention.
Yes, I shall have to bend your supple mind in more stricter fashion. I think the situation calls for some Shakespeare.
Will you please try to act with some decorum?
So you like her?
Mrs. Shakespeare, she's my refuge, Edmund. I can't thank you enough.
My gifts are nothing next to yours. My writing is wood compared to your wild constructions.
Yes, I'm a wild beast. I'm sure Sir Thomas would agree.
Don't concern yourself with his gravity, Fanny. There's many things to preoccupy him.
Such as? Edmund.
It's complex.
And I'm too simple.
Fanny.
He regrets taking me in, doesn't he?
No, it's... It's just its problems with the slaves and the plantation. The abolitionists are making inroads.
Well, that's a good thing, isn't it?
Well, we all live off the profits, Fanny. Including you.
Come back! Tom! as I say.
What, and do as you do? Even I have principles, sir.
Tom!
Ah, you are an angel.
Dear Susie, news items. Sir Thomas has dragged Tom along with him to the West Indies to protect our interests there. Mariah has found herself a fiancé, a Mr. Rushworth, who Sir Thomas has approved by post. Everyone seems delighted with him, except Edmund, who says that if he
had not £12,000 a year, we should think him prodigiously dim.
Consequently, there is a new urgency to Julia's search for a suitor. And Mrs. Norris's husband died, which did not seem to inconvenience her very much at all. She's moved into Mansfield proper, where life is decidedly less expensive for her. What joy is mine? So, now there is a new parson moved into the parsonage, and life seems nothing more than a quick succession of busy nothings.
They are half-brother and sister to the new parson's wife. I expect you to entertain them with suitable attention and animation, not to mention alacrity.
I might need the rest of the morning to recover from the Withrow's ball last night, Mrs. Norris. I'm just a mite sluggish.
Indeed.
Mr. Rushworth, if you please. May I introduce Miss Mary Crawford? And her brother, Mr. Henry Crawford. This is my sister, Lady Bertram. Mr. Edmund Bertram. This is Miss Julia Bertram, who has just come out into society this autumn, as Miss Mariah Bertram here has just become engaged to Mr. Rushworth. Perhaps you passed Mr. Rushworth's magnificent estate on the way here, the one with the spectacular gardens, Southerton.
Actually, we're planning some improvements.
Earn Fanny Price.
Well, you certainly seem a dreary lot.
Please, do join us in our game, Mr. Crawford.
Exceedingly. But I like Julia best.
Why?
Because her Aunt Norris advised me that it must be so.
She certainly seems very ready to be fallen in love with.
Though Mariah is most agreeable.
Though her choice is made.
Yes. And I like her the better for it. An engaged woman is always more agreeable than a disengaged. She is satisfied with herself. Her cares are over, and she feels she may exert all her powers of pleasing without suspicion. All is safe with a lady engaged. No harm can be done.
You allow yourself great latitude on such points, Henry. But you will be the one taken in at last.
I cannot know if he loves me, said Eliza. Well, I asked, did he never gaze on you with admiration, tenderly press your hand, drop an involuntary tear, and leave the room abruptly? Never, replied she. He's always left the room, indeed, when his visit has been ended. Edmund, so what do you think?
She's delightful. They're both delightful.
There could be no harm in my liking an agreeable man. Everybody knows my situation.
Must you always win? Even when you already have your prize.
Julia, Julia, there will be little rubs and disappointments everywhere if one scheme of happiness fails. Human nature turns to another.
Well, you may need your pretty philosophy in the end, Mariah.
Pity Tom the eldest is not here.
All with his £20,000 and his baronessy and everything.
Henry. You know those things mean nothing to me.
Shall we stay on a while?
Yes, please.
Of life rarely transcend a moment such as this. Don't you agree, Pugsy?
Tom, damn you!
Tom, are you well? Oh. Is there war? Where's Sir Thomas? What news? Edmund, come quickly!
Tom, what of Antigua? Where's father?
Ah, yes, Antigua. All the lovely people there paying for this party.
Tom, we thought you were in Antigua.
Tom returned from Antigua somewhat sooner than expected, so he spent a while in London. I found him in the green room of the Covent Garden Theatre.
In a theatre?
Yes, it happens to be where they're restaging this delicious little slice of naughtiness called Lover's Vows.
Oh, I've heard of that.
But Tom was a charming parasite to the process until he ran out of cash. And since I found myself quite capable of sympathising with the tragedy of unwarranted poverty, I chose to deliver him to his family, whom I now find to be so very loving and beautiful.
And solvent.
Solvent?
Mr. Bertram?
At any rate, the Baron meets the bastard son, takes back the lover of his youth, and they all live happily, well, it is to be presumed, for some time ever after.
Bravo, Tom!
Well told, Tom.
More dim-witted fiction to clutter the world.
Oh, come now, Mr. Bertram. Drama is to life what ships are to the sea. A means to traverse it, to plumb its depths, its breadth, and its beauty.
I couldn't agree more, Miss Crawford. Good drama, in which the greatest powers of the mind are displayed, in which the most thorough knowledge of human nature, the liveliest effusions of wit and humour are conveyed to the world through the best chosen language. Yes, this is essential.
This is trash. So serious. That is the worst charge, isn't it, Tom?
What do you think, Miss Price?
I'm sorry to disappoint Mr. Crawford, but I do not have a ready opinion.
I suspect you're almost entirely composed of ready opinions not shared.
Fanny?
Yes, Aunt Norris.
What are you doing here?
I beg your pardon.
You are aware, surely, that the sailing wasn't cleared away from yesterday afternoon.
Oh. Yes, you're quite right. It wasn't. I'll see to it immediately.
Aunt Norris, surely the sewing can wait.
Pray, is she out?
Or is she not? Into society?
I can't see that it matters terribly.
Oh, forget this out, not out nonsense. I say we stage the play. Here. Now, together.
Oh, Yatesy, you're a genius. Why, this is the very room for a theatre. And Father's study will provide for an excellent stage.
It has been mentioned that I have quite a gift for the stage, actually.
Tom, you're not serious.
Hmm? Not serious? Me?
Lover's vows. I'm convinced that our father would disapprove.
I think I know our father as well as you do. Manage your own concerns, Edmund, and let me take care of the rest of the family. Don't act yourself if you do not like it, but please, don't try to govern everybody else. All settled, then? Good!
What? What's the matter? I was not asleep.
Oh, no. No, of course not, ma'am. No one suspected you.
Where's Fanny? Norris, get me Fanny Price.
I wish to play Amelia. But what I'm keen to know is which gentleman among you am I to have the pleasure of making love to?
And how has it happened that the wish to do what is right has become an unattractive quality? And now Tom wants to enlist Charles Maddox to play Anhalt. He's about as discreet as the town crier.
So this is where you hide. Fanny, I need some rehearsing. Would you mind? Oh, Mr. Bertram. Hello.
Hello, Miss Crawford. I'll be off then, Fanny.
Oh, stay. We need an audience. We all need an audience, wouldn't you say, Fanny?
To be truthful, I live in dread of audiences.
Come, here. I will play Amelia, and you from now will play Anot, the clergyman, my teacher.
No.
Read from there, since Mr. Bertram here refuses. I insist.
Very well. For a long time, you have instructed me.
Why should not I now begin to teach you?
Teach me what?
Whatever I know and you don't.
There are some things I'd rather never know.
Just as you made certain mathematical problems pleasant to me, I might teach something as pleasant to you.
Woman herself is a problem.
And I'll teach you to make her out.
You teach?
Why not? None but a woman can teach the science of herself.
Upon reconsideration, I cannot help but think that, despite the displeasure of appearing inconsistent, it would be better for me to play Anhalt than invite Charles Maddox into this mixture.
Excellent.
There are some things I'd rather never know.
What is this? How is this? And why do I find my mother thus? Speak.
I cannot speak, my dear son. My dear Frederick, I was not prepared.
Dear mother, compose yourself. Now then.
Hello, my sweet dear girl.
Welcome home, sir.
My word. You've grown in health. And I dare say, beauty. Now, where are the rest? Julia, Mariah. What's that?
Well, it's...
Improvements? Badly.
Oh, you must be Sir Thomas. I am Rushworth, your future son-in-law. We are in the midst of a home theatrical. I am to be Count Castle and come in first with a blue dress and a pink satin cloak and afterwards have another fine fancy suit by way of a shooting dress. I have 2:40 speeches, which is no trifle.
Father, Tom, so this is what you're in such a terrible hurry to leave Antigua for, I presume.
Oh, Sir Thomas, I could not have borne your absence a moment longer.
Dear Susie, all remnants of the theatre have been erased, and Tom and Yates have fled the new solemnity that has returned to Mansfield Park.
Do tell us more about the Negroes, dear.
Yes, the mulattoes are in general well-shaped, and the women especially well-featured. I have one so easy and graceful in her movements and intelligent as well. But you know, strangely, two mulattoes can never have children. They're like mules in that respect.
Excuse me, Father, for contradicting you, but that is nonsense. You cannot say such things.
I did not say they are mules, did I? I said they are like mules. Edward Long's History of Jamaica. Read it before you challenge me. Anyway, I have a good mind to bring one of them back with me next trip to work here as a domestic.
Correct me if I am in error, Sir Thomas, but I've read, sir, that if you were to bring one of the slaves back to England, there would be some argument as to whether or not they should be freed here. If I'm not mistaken.
I must say, you've changed considerably, my dear.
I've done some reading on the matter. Thomas Clarkson, to be specific, under Edmund's guidance.
Fanny has a voracious mind, Father, as hungry as any man's. And her writing is remarkable, in a style entirely new.
Yes, good. Yes. Your complexion is so improved.
I trust you will see as much beauty of mind in time, Father.
You've gained so much countenance. And your figure...
Please.
Don't you agree, Mr. Crawford?
Purity is a decided attraction, tis true, Sir Thomas.
Indeed.
Especially for the impure.
Must be the moral taste and the steadfastness of her heart that illuminate her eyes and give such a glow to her cheek.
Please.
Gentlemen, Fanny Price is almost as fearful of notice and praise as other women are of neglect.
Most discerning, Miss Crawford.
Thank you, Mr. Bertram.
I have it. A ball at Mansfield Park, in honor of Fanny. We shall bring her out and introduce Miss Fanny Price to society. Surely some young man of good standing will sit up and take notice.
I'm certain she will glide about with quiet, light elegance in an admirable time.
You must excuse me. I think I have something. Excuse me.
It needn't be a large affair, just a few neighbors and friends.
Fanny, don't be foolish. It is raining.
I see more distinctly through the rain.
It's just a silly ball.
I'll not be sold off like one of your father's slaves, Edmund.
Oh, don't be an imbecile.
Oh, but imbecility in women is a great enhancement to their personal charms.
Fanny, you're being irrational.
Get another adornment. I must be ravishing.
Fanny, you really must begin to harden yourself to the idea of being worth looking at.
Worse, Edmund.
Sir?
She is witty and bright, and I dare say not without worth.
And how might you measure that worth, Father?
Oh, you need not impress me with your purity. Her family is well established, it is well known.
The Prices?
The Crawfords, Edmund. I meant the Crawfords. Mary Crawford.
What are you reading?
Lawrence Stern's A Sentimental Journey.
Oh. May I? I was interrupted with a voice which I took to be of a child, which complained it could not get out. I looked up and down the passage and saw it was a starling hung in a little cage. I can't get out. I can't get out, said the starling. God help thee, said I. But I'll let thee out, cost what it will. But it was double twisted with wire, and there was no getting it open without pulling the cage to pieces. I took both hands to it. The bird flew to the place where I was attempting his deliverance, and thrusting his head through the trellis, pressed his breast against it as if impatient. I fear, poor creature, said I. I cannot set thee at liberty. No, said the starling. I can't get out. I can't get out, said the starling.
You read well.
Thank you.
Father, I wish to speak to you about Rushworth.
Maria, yes. Now, you know how eagerly disposed I was to like your Mr. Rushworth.
But you think him an inferior young man? As ignorant in business as in books, with opinions in general unfixed and without seeming much aware of it himself.
Well,
I'm not blind, Father.
Perhaps the alliance, advantageous as it is, was too quickly agreed to. You need not worry, Maria. I shall take care of you. Every inconvenience should be braved, and the connection entirely given up.
if you feel yourself unhappy in the prospect of it.
I will not pretend he is of shining character. But I will also not pretend that enjoying a larger income, a house in the city, and all the other amiable and innocent pleasures the connection will afford are not an attraction. As for the rest, well, he's still young. And I would like to marry him immediately, within a fortnight.
I do not understand the urgency.
I don't understand the delay. And I would like for Julia to accompany me on the honeymoon.
And you wish for Julia to accompany you on your honeymoon?
Yes. But she's never been to Brighton.
Dear Susie, Mariah was married on Saturday. In all important preparations of mind, she was complete, being prepared for matrimony by a hatred of home, by the misery of disappointed affection, and contempt of the man she was to marry. The bride was elegantly dressed, and the two bridesmaids were duly inferior. Her mother stood with salts in her hand, expecting to be agitated, and her aunt tried to cry. Marriage is indeed a maneuvering business.
Beautiful.
Goodbye, my precious. Bye.
It is a comfort to think that you will never leave us, Fanny.
I should be selfish and keep you here to stay and play with me. She must forgive me. Selfishness must always be forgiven, you know, because there's no hope of a cure.
Oh, so lovely. Tomorrow evening, the ballroom shall be lit solely by your beauty.
Miss Crawford.
Oh, you do have a fine form, my dear. I've no wonder Edmund delights so in your company. I'm so evil. He knows not what to make of me. Would that I had your sound judgment. Tell me, does he speak of me? Occasionally? Is that your harp in the front room? Oh, indeed. It was transported from London on Henry's carriage. I tried to hire a horse and cart, found that I'd been asking the most unreasonable, most impossible thing in the world. I'd offended all the farmers, all the labourers, and all the hay in the parish. Getting the hay in is of great importance in the country at this time. And music isn't. It depends on the music, I suppose.
Edmund says that in a church service, it is music that best allows the spirit to aspire to the beyond.
Oh, heavens. Why waste it on drowsy churchgoers starched up into seeming piety? Give me a concert or a dance. I'm sure he'd agree.
Forgive my contradiction, Miss Crawford, but I'm sure he wouldn't.
When he takes orders in a few weeks, he will begin, if I'm not mistaken, his own services.
Takes orders? What, is Edmund to be a clergyman?
Yes.
Oh, but a clergyman is so drear. And a clergyman's wife is even worse.
What profession would you suggest, Miss Crawford? I'm not, as you know, the firstborn.
Oh, there must be an uncle or grandfather to place you somewhere.
There is not.
Well, choose law then. It's not too late. At least you can distinguish yourself there with language and wit.
I really have no wish to blunder about on the borders of empty repartee.
Or your father could put you into Parliament.
My father's choices are less than compelling for me. No, I wish to become a clergyman. I think there are worse things than a life of compassion and contemplation. She does not think evil, but she speaks it. It grieves me to the soul.
The effect of education, perhaps.
Perhaps I can uneducate her. Fanny, would that more women were like you. I love you more than words can say. I demand the first dance at the ball tomorrow.
One's consequence varies so much at times without any particular reason.
There's a reason for everything, Fanny. Your entire person is entirely agreeable.
Yes, well, tonight I agree with everyone. Edmund, I think you should admit that you're in love with Fanny Price.
Well, of course I love her. But there are as many forms of love as there are moments in time.
Perfect. Dance like an angel, Fanny Price.
It's not dance like an angel alone, Mr. Crawford.
What? A compliment? Let the heavens rejoice, she complimented me.
Did your dancing, Mr. Crawford. Keep your wiggle. And then a few hours before Laura died, she said, "Take warning from my unhappy end. Beware of fainting fits. Beware of swoons."
Good afternoon.
Sir Thomas.
Hello, Sir Thomas. Good afternoon, sir.
Yeah.
Sir Thomas, I've been thinking about the parsonage.
Not you too.
Spades are trumps, Fanny. I'm all in the glow, Sir Thomas, of a new scheme.
Ah, and what might that be?
I thought you might be amenable to renting the parsonage to me.
But it is to be Edmund's parsonage when he takes orders.
Anyone care to purchase a queen?
At what cost?
2 shillings.
Highway robbery.
Mr. Bertram could continue here at Mansfield Park and still be preacher. This way you stay closer to your dear family, and I continue improving and perfecting that friendship and intimacy with the Mansfield Park family, which is increasing in value to me every day.
I have a better plan, Henry. Live here with us.
Stay as long as you wish, every season. Bring all your horses. And your sister, too.
Be as one of our family. We would thrive on it, wouldn't we, Fanny?
Of course. He'll buy the king for 3 shillings. I know.
Mary, it's exorbitant.
I shall stake my last like a woman of spirit. No cold prudence for me. I was not made to sit still and do nothing. If I lose the game, it shall not be for not striving for it.
Ah. Well done, Fanny.
Fanny!
I must speak to you.
Yes, Mr. Crawford.
You must know why I'm attempting to rent the parsonage. I wish to continue improving and perfecting my intimacy with you. Fanny, you have created sensations which my heart has never known before.
Please.
There is only one happiness in life, to love and be loved.
Mr. Crawford, do not speak nonsense.
Nonsense?
You're such a fine speaker that I'm afraid you may actually end in convincing yourself.
Fanny! You are killing me.
No man dies of love but on the stage. From this period, the intimacy between them daily increased till at length it grew to such a pitch that they did not scruple to kick one another out of the window on the slightest provocation. Yes?
Ah, oh, my sweet girl. This is a great day. A great day indeed.
Yes, it is.
You may make me more proud, I dare say, than my own daughters.
Oh, please don't say that, sir.
Why is there no fire here today?
I'm not cold, sir.
But you have a fire in general?
No, sir, but I have a warm shawl.
Your aunt cannot be aware of this. I understand. For as long as you're in my home, Fanny Price, you shall have a fire. I'm aware that there has been a misplaced distinction, but I think too well of you to suppose that you will ever harbor resentment on that account. Thus, it is with even more pleasure that I'm here to inform you that Henry Crawford has asked my permission to take your hand in marriage, and I have given the union my blessing. I had no idea that his feelings had progressed to such a boiling point. Clearly, I'm too old to follow the intricate maneuverings of the young. Please get yourself ready and join me downstairs. Mr. Crawford, as you've perhaps foreseen, is still in the house. Do not fear.
I cannot, sir.
Cannot what?
I cannot agree to marry him at this time.
You do not know your own feelings. I've watched you with him, Fanny Price. I know you're not insensitive to his charms. I'm not that old.
He's not without charm, sir.
Has someone else declared his intention for you?
No, sir.
Then what is it?
I do not trust him, sir.
What do you distrust?
His nature, sir. Like many charming people, he conceals an almost absolute dependence on the appreciation of others.
And what is the terrible ill in that?
His sole interest is in being loved, sir, not in loving.
You've read too many novels, girl.
I am an unabashed novel reader, sir, but I do not think it has clouded my judgment.
Do you trust me?
I trust that my future is entirely dependent upon you, sir.
Let me repeat. Do you trust me?
Yes, sir.
Well, I trust him. You will marry him.
I will not. Sir.
I had Fanny Price. Thought you free from willfulness of temper, self-conceit, and every tendency to that independence of spirit which prevails so much in modern days, even in young women. And which in young women is especially offensive and disgusting, beyond all common offense. You seem to have forgotten that you do not have Mary Crawford's annual income, for example. Nor does your family. Their advantage or disadvantage never seems to have had a moment's share in your thoughts. Here is a young man wishing to pay his addresses to you, with everything to recommend him. Not merely situation in life, fortune, and character, but with more than common agreeableness, with address and conversation pleasing to everybody. And he is not an acquaintance of today. You've now known him some time. His sister, moreover, is your intimate friend. Some time aware of a particularity in Mr. Crawford's manners. Cannot have taken you by surprise. You must have observed his attentions, and though you always received them very
properly. I am half inclined to think, Fanny, that you do not quite know your own feelings.
It is of no use, I perceive, to talk to you. We had better put an end to this most mortifying conference. I will therefore...
And because you do not feel for Mr. Crawford exactly what a young, heated fancy imagines to be necessary for happiness...
I should say not.
You are, in a wild fit of folly, throwing away from you such an opportunity of being settled in life. Eligibly, honorably, nobly settled. As will probably never occur to you again.
And I will tell you what, Fanny Price, which is more than I did for Maria, the next time that Buck has a litter, you shall have a puppy.
All she needs is time, Sir Thomas. He loves you, Fanny Price. If any man ever loved a woman forever, I think Henry would do as much for you.
Edmund, what are your thoughts?
The fact that he chose you, Fanny, is evidence of his good character. He could make you very happy. And you would be the making of him.
Well, I think it ought not to be set down as certain that a man must be acceptable to every woman he may happen to like himself.
Perhaps you would rather return to Portsmouth. I can write to your mother tonight. A little abstinence from the luxuries and elegances of Mansfield Park might bring your mind into a more sober state. Is that your choice, young woman?
Yes. It is.
Why, Fanny?
To be at home again, to be loved by my family, to feel affection without fear or restraint, and to feel myself the equal of those that surround me. I hope you know how much I shall write to you.
And I shall write to you. When I have anything worth writing about.
Oh!
Mother!
Fanny! Come in. You must be exhausted from your journey.
No, it's surprisingly short, really.
Look at you. So... Betsy, get Father up. Come in. Come in. So, did you have a tiring journey? You must be exhausted. Oh, okay. Betsy!
I got him up yesterday.
I suppose you must have a multitude of servants.
I have to do quite a lot, actually. I'm right hand of Lady Bertram and Aunt Norris.
I only have the two girls. We had some help, but now your father has no work at present, so...
Hello.
How long are you here for, Fanny?
Cannot say exactly.
Father won't get up. She's here.
Oh, hello.
Hello. Oh, come here, Uncle.
Oh, Fanny. You look so fancy. Like a princess. I told you she would be beautiful, Mother. Didn't I tell you she would be beautiful?
Yes, you did.
Father, Fanny's come home. Here she is.
Turn around, then. Come on, let's have a look at you. Turn around. Lovely. Come here, chatterbox. I'm just teasing you. You give your coarse old father a big squeeze. Welcome home, Fanny. Good to have another girl around. Well, I'm about ready. You just throw down some straw and call this place a stall.
Don't get me started.
Beware of fainting fits, beware of swoons. A frenzy fit is not one quarter so pernicious. It is an exercise to the body, and if not too violent, is, I dare say, conducive to health.
Fanny, a letter! Who is it from?
Mary Crawford. Friend. Oh, how we miss you, my dearest Fanny Price. My brother is moping. Please write me a pretty letter in reply to gladden his eyes. And send me an account of all the dashing young captains whom you disdained for his sake.
I have seen Julia and dearest Mrs. Rushworth at Wimpole Street the other day. We seemed very glad to see each other, and I do really think we were a little. We had a vast deal to say, especially on the subject of you and Henry. Shall I tell you how Mrs. Rushworth looked when your name was mentioned?
Fanny. Fanny Price.
I did not used to think her wanting in self-possession, but she had not quite enough for the demands of yesterday.
Well, I shall believe it when I believe it, Henry Crawford.
So you shall, Mrs. Rushworth.
And as for Edmund, clergyman or not, let me say, I am increasingly sensitive to his charms.
Yours affectionately, Mary Crawford.
Betsy! This Henry Crawford, what's he like?
A rake, I think.
Yes, please.
They amuse more in literature than they do in life, Susan.
Ah, but they amuse. And Lady Bertram?
She's always suffering near fatal fatigue.
Why?
Generally from embroidering something of little use and no beauty, not to mention a handsome dose of opium daily.
Your tongue is sharper than a guillotine, Fanny.
The effect of education, I suppose.
Thank you.
Miss Price! Miss Fanny Price! Miss Price!
What is that racket?
Miss Price!
What is it, boy?
I must see Fanny Price! Miss Price? Miss Fanny Price!
I'm Fanny Price.
Are you sure? Because I don't get paid if you're not.
Yes, I'm sure I'm Fanny Price.
All right then, stay back.
To say something he said about Starling's flying or something. Some romantic thing, but I can't remember exactly.
Yes, well, I think we've got the general idea. Thank you.
Fanny, what is this?
Price.
Yes?
Henry Crawford. Friend of...
Mariah Bertram.
Pleased to meet you.
And you must be Mrs. Price. Of course, I see the resemblance to your sisters, the beautiful Lady Bertram and Mrs. Norris. Nature has given your family no inconsiderable share of beauty.
You're too kind, Mr. Crawford.
Miss Price.
Mr. Crawford. It was you, wasn't it? The birds and everything.
I'm sorry, I do not know to what you're referring.
So, tell me, what is the news of Mansfield? How is everyone?
Everyone being Edmund. Fanny, I know.
You know what, Henry?
I know you love Edmund. I wish to speak in truths. I suspect this is the effect of your education of me, Fanny Price. He is a fine man, I understand, but he's to be married, Fanny, to my sister.
The words have been spoken.
All but.
I shall wait to grieve until then.
It pains me to tell you that you must grieve now. I know I have an appearance of inauthenticity. You're infinitely my superior in merit. You have touches of the angel in you. And I know you have witnessed my insincere attentions toward Mariah. But your eyes are so clear and unflinching, I beg you to look at me again. I am changed, Fanny Price, I am changed. I shall wait for you. Till the end of time, my constancy shall prove that I am changed.
It is your very changefulness that frightens me, Mr. Crawford.
Toy with me.
No. Senseless as it is, my heart is still full of another.
And I shall wait. Till it is free once more.
It is the habits of wealth that I fear. Still, she is the only woman in the world whom I could ever think of as... Still, she is the only woman in the world whom I could ever think of as... a wife.
Thank you.
Where would your current tenants go if we were to move into that house?
I have several apartments and houses here, sir. The others would be well cared for.
It is a generous offer.
Well, the first of many, I hope.
It's mine. Ow.
Fanny.
Yes.
I've been thinking, Fanny. There is no shame in wealth, my dear. It depends on how it's arrived at.
Come here.
Just remember, Fanny. I married for love.
How does it feel to be home?
Portsmouth is Portsmouth and Mansfield is home.
You don't like to be near the water?
Not if it smells, and one has not the means to float away upon it.
You have?
Poverty frightens me. And a woman's poverty is a slavery even more harsh than a man's.
Hmm. Arguable. But it need not be your lot.
I know.
You spend your days in comfort. With me. You do?
Yes.
Is that a yes?
Yes.
Is that the yes I have heard a thousand times in my heart, but not from you? Fanny Price. You will learn to love me. Say it again, please. Say it.
Yes.
Good morning, Miss Price. Good morning, my
please,
darling.
Please stop, please.
Good
please
morning.
Stop, please stop it. Charlie, come on. I spoke hastily. I've anguished over the matter, and I feel that I cannot marry you. I'm not prepared.
When might you be prepared?
Come on, sorry.
When might that be?
I still doubt you, and I fear you cannot be trusted.
Doubt me! And your behavior this day is that of someone trustworthy. You are the standard of trust.
Forgive me.
Enjoy your stay in Portsmouth, Miss Price. May it be long, up to your standards.
I have no talent for certainty, Susie.
Fanny, come quickly.
Fanny. Who's to pay for all this paper, Fanny? Come. Edmund.
I've come to take you back to Mansfield. You're needed there.
What's happened?
Tom was celebrating in Newmarket and fell ill. And the group of young men he was travelling with left him behind to recover with Yates, who then deserted him as well. He was found alone, almost dead 2 days ago. The situation is very grave. We must hurry. If you wish to, that is.
Fanny, I cannot tell you how much I shall see you soon, Susie. I feel it.
Go on, there.
Remember, run mad as often as you choose, but do not faint.
I trust other than this tragedy you will.
Yes. As I intimated in my last letter, I believe Mary has almost reconciled herself to marrying a stodgy clergyman. I understand Crawford paid you a visit.
Yes.
Was he attentive?
Yes.
Has your heart changed towards him?
Yes, several times. I find that.
Surely you and I are beyond speaking when words are clearly not enough.
Thank you.
Fanny, you're back.
Yes, sir.
Good. We've had our fill of estrangement at Mansfield Park.
Good morning, sir.
Oh, my dear Mr. Crawford, thank you for joining us at this difficult time. Mrs. Rushworth will be joining us later today as well. Of course, Mr. Rushworth is detained with improvements to his garden at Southerton. You'll be very glad to know that Miss Julia is due within the hour.
Welcome. Fanny, thank you for coming.
Fanny, I've been meaning to ask you, how long are you staying?
I'm not certain, Aunt Norris. And how long are you staying?
Mrs. Rushworth. Trust you are well.
Yes, I'm fine, thank you.
And Mr. Rushworth. Mariah. This is the behavior of friends. Mariah. Please.
How's Fanny?
She's a good little girl.
And you've become a good little boy.
She's rejected me, Mariah.
Would that this sigh were for me.
visit. What?
What's wrong?
What?
Don't look at me like that, Edmund. Rushworth is a fool, you know that, and I can't get out. Edmund. I can't get out.
Mansfield Park!
Ah. Get Edmund and Sir Thomas and Maria. We have an important guest here today.
Edmund!
This is Mr. Dixon of the London Times. He is writing an article about modern gardens and is interested in the changes at Sowerton.
Where's Maria?
The clever fellow has noticed the influence of Gilpin. He loves the new ruins.
Wake up, you degenerate lot! Hello? Maria? Sir? Sir?
Where's Maria?
I could not say.
At this hour?
Then we'll speak to Crawford. It was on his recommendation that we remove the avenue of old oaks that led from the west front up to the top of the hill. Where is Crawford?
At the parsonage with the Grants?
No, we stopped there first.
Sir Thomas, there's something you must read. Oh, dear, dear, dear. It is quite startling here in the society section.
Fanny, you read it to us. You have such a strong, clear voice.
It is with infinite concern the newspaper has to announce to the world a matrimonial fracas in the family of Mr. Rushworth of Wimpole Street.
Go on.
The beautiful Mrs. Rushworth, who had promised to become so brilliant a leader in the fashionable world, has quitted her husband's roof in company with a well-known and captivating Mr. Crawford, the intimate friend and associate of not only Mr. Rushworth, but Mrs. Rushworth's father, Sir Thomas Bertram of Mansfield Park. It is not known even to the editor of the newspaper whither they have gone.
May God help us.
The fools.
under this roof. They should have known Rushworth would do something stupid, such as bring in a newspaper man.
Under which roof would it have been better, Mary?
I understand your bitterness, Fanny Price, but do not direct it at me.
Your brother is an actor. A charming, inscrutable actor through and through.
It's just that the temptation of immediate pleasure was too strong for a mind unused to making any sacrifice.
After all the cost and care of an anxious and expensive education, I do not feel I know my own children at all.
Now, please, of course you know them. This is 1806, for heaven's sake. This is not the first time that this has happened in the world, nor the last. Look, you are indeed a family in distress, but you must recover and survive gracefully. The facts are that if Henry does not choose to marry Maria, and if you also reject her, she will be an outcast.
A leaf in the wind of other men's plans.
Or we can recover. Here is my proposal. We must persuade Henry to marry Maria. After a respectable period, Edmund and I will accept Maria and Henry into our acquaintance and household. And then the rest of you, after an appropriate period of distance, will decide to properly support them as well. And the Bertrams, being people of respectability, as they are, she may recover her footing in society to a certain degree. In some circles, we know she would never be admitted, but with good dinners and large parties, there will always be those who will be glad of her acquaintance.
Such a developed strategy. And how will a poor clergyman afford these good dinners and large parties?
Chance is not always unkind.
I beg your pardon.
If Tom is not able to recover, Edmund will be the heir. And wealth and consequence could fall into hands no more deserving. I understand you think I should not say such things. But one must prepare oneself for every eventuality. It is the mark of an evolved individual.
No.
No, what I advise is that you, Sir Thomas, do not injure your own cause by interference. Let things take their course. That, I understand, may be a difficult thing. But although Tom, bless his heart, may not be strong enough for this world, the rest of us must be. I speak merely of what must be done, not what I feel.
You may wish to reconsider your eagerness for Tom's death.
And you may wish to reconsider your thinly veiled anger towards me, Fanny Price. If you'd accepted my brother as you ought, you might now have been on the point of marriage, and Henry would have taken no pains to be on terms with Mrs. Rushworth again. It would have all ended in a regular standing flirtation in yearly meetings at Southerton and Everingham. It could all be construed as your fault.
Your startling adaptability to my brother's possible demise sends a chill through my heart. A chill. And cheerfully planning parties with his money. You shush my father like a dog at your table. You attack Fanny for following her own infallible internal guide about matters of the heart. All this has most grievously convinced me that the person I've been too apt to dwell on for many months past has been a creature of my own imagination. Not you, Miss Crawford. You are a stranger to me. I do not know you, and I'm sorry to say I have no wish to.
Thank you. Is there anything to be done?
Wait.
Wait.
Yes. Time could do almost anything.
He survived brain fever when he was six. He used to play Tom the Knight. Give me a mission, Father. I'd send him with a message to Mother about the tea, or to get badly, to get the carriage ready. No, Father. Give me a noble mission. That's all he ever wanted.
In good and perfect time, Tom's health did return. Henry Crawford chose not to marry Maria. Mrs. Norris, who Sir Thomas came to regard as an hourly evil, went to devote herself to her unfortunate niece. It may be reasonably supposed that their tempers became their mutual punishment. It could have turned out differently, I suppose. But it didn't. Crawford went to live in Westminster. Eventually, she and Henry found partners who shared their more modern sensibilities. And, as you may have guessed, at exactly the time when it was quite natural that it should be so, and not a moment sooner, Edmund came to speak the whole delightful and astonishing truth.
Fanny, I must confess something. I've loved you all my life.
I know, Edmund.
No, Fanny. As a man loves a woman. As a hero loves a heroine. As I've never loved anyone in my entire life. I'm so anxious to do what is right that I forgot to do what is right. But if you choose me, after all my blundering and blindness,
be a happiness which no description could reach.
Getting somewhere.
Julia?
Mr. Yates?
Now, Joan of Arc lived during the reign of Henry the Sixth. Is that correct?
Yes, Susie.
I knew that. Yes, I did.
Susan came to live at Mansfield Park. Tom grew stronger by the day, and Sir Thomas eventually abandoned his pursuits in Antigua. He chose instead to pursue some exciting new opportunities in tobacco. It could have all turned out differently, I suppose. But it didn't.
By the way, I spoke to a John Ward at Edgerton's, and he said he'd be willing to publish.
My stories?
At our expense, of course, but you'd get to keep 10% of the profits. Now, I was thinking of a title. Effusions of Fancy by a Very Young Girl in a Style Entirely New. What do you think?
That's very interesting.
Just interesting.